I'm so pleased that our Vice-Chancellor is here, Professor Mamokgethi Phakeng.
I want to speak from the podium because I'm pretty small and you probably don't see me sitting there. Yes. So, thank you very much, Tate Maloka, for collaborating with us in this initiative. We were very delighted when we were elected as President of Convocation because we are serious about our agenda for Africa, and we thought with you being elected as President of Convocation, it will give us an opportunity to collaborate and participate even more in collaboration with other institutions on the continent. Justice, thank you so much for joining. UKTABA is a key stakeholder. Of course, I'm looking forward to the proper homecoming. This is not the homecoming. This is a visit, but we're looking forward to the UKTABA homecoming, hopefully before the end of this year or next year. But it will be good to have all the black alumni come back to UCT. My view all the time is that the alumni own the university. Vice chancellors come and go, but it's the alumni who cannot divorce the university. And so it's always important to have them back at the university so that they realize what is it that they own. They don't just bring students to the university. So the buildings and all the infrastructure on campus, they should take interest in them. How are they? Because if UCT falls apart, then it is their careers that fall apart. Good morning, friends, Khuyamore, Sanbonani, Mulweni, Jumela, everyone, happy Africa Month. And welcome to the University of Cape Town for this important symposium on young leadership and Africanism and regional integration. You see, for us at UCT, these terms, young leadership, Pan-Africanism, and regional integration are not idle words. We are proudly an African university. Sometimes people argue with me when I say we are proudly African university. We are proudly African. We decide who we are, and we are telling you that we are proudly African. If we do not look African, don't worry. The fact that we've decided that we are proudly African is just a matter of time before you recognize us and see that we look African. So we are a proudly African university and a proud incubator of young African talent and leadership. And it is within the context of African academic leadership that I would like to speak to you today. 4 years ago, a wave of student protest began on this campus around a colonial statue. The statue was removed within just a month, but the protest continued, taking up fresh courses and reverberating around the world as young people questioned the basis of our educational institutions and our approaches to knowledge creation and ownership. As a result, as an institution, we are still today contending with the effects of the hashtag roads must fall in the intellectual and symbolic space, the fees must fall in the material and admission space, and the outsourcing must fall in the employment space. We are now redefining our approaches to education and how we model leadership to students and rising academics. And that's why Dr. Maloka wanted us to focus on the youth, because the youth are the majority of people on this continent. Soon, the working population will be our young people here on the continent. Many have seen the protest movement as an attack on higher education, but I see them as a challenge and as an invitation to rethink the idea of the university, perhaps towards a multiversity that enlarges reservoirs of knowledge, enhances epistemic competition, fosters diversity as inclusiveness, and not simply as tolerance, and advocates anti-racism so that the academic project can flourish. My view is that until the must fall movement, institutions like universities dealt with transformation as a matter of compliance rather than as a matter of change in structures, ways of doing, ways of knowing, and ways of being. We submitted our employment equity plans to the Department of Labor. The Department of Labor ticked the box and said we are fine, but actually on the ground, much wasn't happening. We have seen through history that real transformation is not just about the transfer of power from one elite to another. If we only transfer power, then the people will continue to feel powerless, marginalized, and disillusioned. As we know, in many quarters, people are feeling right now. While changing the social composition of power is important, that is, the numbers are important, we have to realize that it is not sufficient. We also need to transform the structures as well as ways of doing, knowing, and being. The university is just one arena of exercising the kind of thinking that is coming out of these protests or the Fallist movement. This new activism of the past few years is profoundly about political change. It confronts constitutional agnosticism, it confronts corruption and privilege, all of which feed inequality. Many of us are against inequality, and we want to work against inequality. But in fact, this new activism argues that what they are against and they are fighting against is inequality. Many of us don't look at constitutional agnosticism, corruption and privilege and how they play out and create inequality. We have to contend with the fact that democracy has not changed the apparatus of the state, nor has it rethought the idea of the university. While 1994 provided a political solution to end apartheid, it did not reconstruct society in profound economic and structural ways. Instead, we face a swelling tide of political unrest as champions of economic liberation are flexing their revolutionary muscles. And this is true not only in South Africa, but in many ways across the continent and in some places across the global south, actually. What the new activism says to me is that society's patience has grown thin in the face of corruption, inequality, and poverty. While inequality certainly expresses itself in economic terms, it also manifests in how we respond to the other, to someone of a different race, of a different gender, religion, or sexual identity, to the neighbor in the township who migrated here from a poorer country, to the person who speaks a different language or has a noticeable accent. The new activist is angry, and that anger often expresses itself in vandalism. The burning of our commuter trains, the xenophobic attacks, crime, gender-based violence, the bombing of mosques and synagogues. In the current economic system, the poor have figured out that they have very little to lose. Vandalism, of course, cannot be condoned. It is not acceptable, because in the end, it affects the poor more harshly. And so we should condemn it. But more than that, we should understand why it's happening and then work proactively to make sure that we do not get into a situation where we only react because vandalism is happening. Recently, speaking to heads of departments at UCT, I argued that we've got to work at peace, not because there's war. We've got to work at creating an environment of peace, not because there's contestation and there's unrest. But we should work at it, even when it looks peaceful, because it helps us to create a sustainable state of peace. So when we talk about young leadership and about regional integration, we need to include a discussion of how we respond to the young leaders who have risen in the last 6 or 7 years, and to the next generation of young leaders that will follow. And for us who work at universities, they come here on our campus, and for the first time, they have freedom. They experience freedom to be who they want to be, far from their parents, far from a teacher who's watching them, or from the pastor who sees them every Sunday and perhaps on a Wednesday at a home cell meeting. And so, this becomes a space for them to come out and express their views. We cannot just assume that we can train young leaders to fall into line with our established systems here on the continent and economic models. In any case, those models are likely to lose relevance as the fourth industrial revolution introduces even new ways of communicating, doing business, and learning. All this, of course, reminds me of Paulo Freire's pronouncement in his book, The Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And he wrote, "This then," I quote, "this then is the great humanistic and historical task of the oppressed, to liberate themselves and their oppressors as well. The oppressors who oppress, exploit, and rape by virtue of their power cannot find in this power the strength to liberate their oppressed or themselves. Only power that springs from the weakness of the oppressed will be sufficiently strong to free both. Any attempt to soften the power of the oppressor is deference to the weakness of the oppressed, almost always manifests itself in the form of false generosity. Indeed, the attempt never goes beyond this. In order to have the continued opportunity to express their generosity, the oppressors must perpetuate injustice as well. An unjust social order is the permanent fount of this generosity, which is nourished by death, despair, and poverty. That is why the dispensers of false generosity become desperate at the slightest threat to its source. Close quote. So how do we respond then to the new young leaders who are so intent on change? We need to answer their radicalism with our own radicalism, the kind that can reimagine the university and other structures of society, re-examine the role of each structure and determine its proper focus and purpose. If we don't reimagine it, they will do it for us and then force us to accept the model through threats of vandalism or other ways. I believe a radical re-examination of academic life needs to revive academic debate and intellectual freedom. We need to open ourselves to knowledge from all around the world, not just the traditional Western voices that are always heard. We need to relearn how to disagree even with those voices that we don't want to hear. Rather than shut them down, we've got to learn how to disagree and practice debating with respect for our opponent. The radicalism I'm talking about is not anarchy. Instead, it is about critiquing that which we never took the time to critique in the first place. It's about moving away from populism of what we should protest against or boycott. This is why I'm encouraging the new activism with all its problems and this is why I'm encouraged sometimes by the new activism with all its problems and complexities. It suggests that we have endowed our students with a vision to see the pain that sometimes comes with our hard-won democracy. Democracy is wonderful, but it comes with some pain because it means you open up for the voices that you could always shut down and not hear at all. But it creates pressure that you've got to open and hear them. You've got to be patient and let process play out. And so some of our students have acquired the internal conviction that things must change for the better. And so we give them the space. Of course, we can argue about how they carry out their activism, but we've got to give them the space to express it. And they are not going to wait for anyone to make things better. They're going to do it themselves. That makes me hopeful, because if they understand what democracy is about, then they can allow us to debate rather than shut down debate. More importantly, I'm convinced that we must encourage this change by returning to thoughtful radicalism, all of us, students, staff, adults, and our leaders on the continent. While we consider the role of young leaders in Pan-Africanism, Africa Month is also an opportunity to learn and discover more about the significance of our indigenous African languages. UCT has kept this in mind. Many people do not know, by the way, that here at UCT, we are the only university, actually, where you cannot graduate as a medical doctor unless you pass isiXhosa and you can be able to communicate in isiXhosa. No university does that. And we do that at UCT because our view is that if you're going to be a medical doctor, you're going to work with people who don't look like you, who speak a different language from you. And in this province, the language that people from disadvantaged backgrounds will be speaking is isiXhosa, and we want our doctors to come out being fluent in that language. So we keep our African languages in the foreground. And for Africa Month 2019, UCT libraries will showcase its special collections of archives, books, pamphlets, posters, and films on African indigenous languages. This will include books and pamphlets in a range of African languages from our African Studies Library collection, founded in 1953, and which contain rare and important Africana. The primary focus of our display today will be the Komani Sen Hugh Brody collection, which was first created in support of a series of films by Hugh Brody entitled Tracks Across the Sand. Clips from this series of documentaries will be on display on the 20th of May in the foyer of the Baxter Theatre here. The collection includes all the materials that were generated by 15 years of work with the son of the Southern Kalahari, including 140 hours of original film, maps, GIS databases, family trees, and transcripts of oral history collected in three different languages. By understanding more about our past, we are able to reflect more clearly on the Africa that we want to see today. And we think the best way to reflect more clearly on the Africa we want to see is to do it with young people. And so we look forward to today's engagements. We are glad that young people from high schools around are here, and I'm sure it's going to be an invigorating discussion. Thank you very much.